my comments based on your expectations. So GovDirections is located in Atlanta, Georgia, and we're the publisher of GovDirections.com, GovAdvice, and GovSchool. We serve just over 101,000 registered users who are seeking to do business in the United States and Canada. We also cover Ireland at this point. We've added that at the request of one of our some of our members, and in multiple other agencies that are located in serving countries that from our defense spending. This in 2021, we're going to deliver just over 1.6 million listings to companies who are registered in our system through a daily personalized email. It is a match system. Today's agenda, what we're going to do is talk about the overall marketplace. We're going to talk about the COVID spending up to today and then where we see that going, as well as we're going to show you some past performance research and how you can help you can identify which where projects are at and what the pricing is necessary in order to win that those projects. In a pandemic procurement situation, in an emergency bid situation, you typically can see escalated pricing. And so we want to make sure that you don't leave any money on the table whenever you're pursuing those contracts. But at the same time, we want to make sure that you don't bid too much to lose the opportunity. And we're also going to have an open microphone. So if you have any questions about the process, you're welcome to do that. I'm one of the founders of GovDirections and here to kind of walk you through that process of using our system to really identify. I want to point out that this is the fifth bill or appropriations legislation that's been passed at the federal government level, dealing specifically with COVID-related funding. We started out with H.R. 6074, which is an $8.3 billion bill, included funding initially. We all thought that might be enough to start with, but then quickly realized we had a really big problem on our hands and came back with H.R. 6201, $192 billion influx of procurement related activities. We were only going to focus in on the procurement in these individual bills. H.R. 748, which is the first direct appropriation, actually the reason that number is so high is when they passed along funding specifically to businesses as well as individuals who were directly impacted by COVID, and then started with some of the stimulus type transactions that were that escalated that. But all of those all that legislation included procurement items. That was more emergency focused at time in terms of bedding, dealing with disease issues and so forth. And then we had H.R. 266 was a replenishment of the PPP program, the $489 billion there. But also within that, hospitals received money, and in school systems, some $100 billion related to COVID activities. And then more recently, their legislation that was just passed, H.R. 1319, is $1.9 trillion, and there's a $300 billion specific appropriation, and they're going to state, local, and tribal governments. And that's a significant amount of funding, probably one of the largest appropriations going directly to state and local governments in my history of covering these types of procurement actions. So that's going to replenish a number of states in a number of different areas, and they're going to able to step in there and start spending money on ready-to-go projects in their community, and specifically to address COVID-related activities, such as make sure there's cleansing involved, remediation, replacing HVAC equipment. I'm going to show you some of the items that they've talked about specifically. But just the other day, I saw in one particular county in Georgia, there was a $300,000 transaction specifically just for trees, to plant fruit trees so people can go out and pick the fruit. And so there's all kinds of ways these funds can be used in a community to encourage activities that somehow relieve COVID impact. And so it's important that you're aware of that. You may have an innovative product or innovative way to set that some of these funds can be spent, and you may want to approach your local government. I'm going to kind of talk to you how to go about doing that in the process. But when I talk about legislative action, I always refer back to the Congressional Budget Office, and you see here a link. They really lay it out very well in where the funds actually flow through. And so you can always go to cbo.gov and you could search there with a quick COVID keyword and find these individual publications, but it's laid out in an easy to understand format and fashion so that you can help identify funds which you might be interested in receiving. And also at GovDirections, what we do, and I'll point out in our blog, and we point to this in our individual documents where we cover, and we have interns and others who go in and analyze the actual appropriations and explain to us the process. In this most recent one, which took a little bit longer than necessary because there is such a political divide at the federal level. And I would point out that most of the legislation up to this point has been overwhelmingly approved. This one was a little bit more contentious, but it did pass. And they used something called the reconciliation process. And that's to understand that process is important in to some extent for our members to see how the appropriations move quicker in this type of a transaction. They're able to get to the individual departments and passed along through to the local governments through the CDBG program and others, so that that relief money is going to move a little faster and get out because of that method. And so you have here with the timeline of that, the proposal when it was actually adopted, and an illustration of how that all worked. And then we talk about individual departments that are receiving the funds. And so here, for example, FEMA has 50 billion, losing all my zeros these days, to support distribution and assistance. You know, when you read that, we understand that FEMA will then pass that money along to their local emergency management agency. So in, for example, in Georgia, we have the Georgia Emergency Management Agency, or in California or Texas or New York. So they'll flow those funds into those the community that way through those state emergency agencies. And then in certain areas, the state will depend on the county emergency agency to help with distribution, for example, in logistics related to vaccine distribution. And so if you're in the business of logistics or in staffing resources and others, those funds could potentially help you in the community that you're in. And those projects would be available either through your local county emergency management agency, the state emergency management agency, or the federal. So you want to watch all three levels of those government agencies in order to make sure you don't miss anything. And you'll see each of the various departments here. The Defense Production Act has been put in place, and there's a $10 billion transaction there that includes money for the personal protective equipment and other medical gear that's related to PPE. Okay. As you come in, please make sure you maintain your mute status. It does help us in the process of for the background noise. Okay. Community health centers, another a promotion and distribution. Here, when you see words related to promotion, then you start thinking about communication, marketing funds that are available to help make sure that those the community understands how to go about receiving that vaccine. I think a lot of people currently are in the process of trying to schedule the vaccine and understanding how to do that and making sure the community is fully aware of that. There's a huge effort involved in that for on communications part. And so that can be all the way up into the local government level and just in the community that you're in, that they have some sort of marketing campaign. So make sure when you see those words, mitigation, tracing, those contact tracing bids and so forth, as you see those, that you pick up on those keywords to understand that that all translates into procurement and purchasing to some level. CDC has funds available in administration tracking. This is also for contact tracing. And then the acceleration of making sure that the vaccine is deployed appropriately. And this could be from, you know, renting equipment such as tents other types of furniture that could be used in the process of delivering the product. And so there's all different ways that these funds can be spent. Indian Health Services in different parts of the country, a $5.4 billion appropriation. The community mental health, if you have programs to support that. And this could be, once again, in all different levels in education and making sure our youth are actively involved. And so mental health becomes a very big, broad word and use of that, especially in a block grant program. And so those funds are specifically available in the community, $1.75 billion. Substance abuse prevention, other items were addressed in this particular bill. It's more of a social orientation than some of the previous ones, to make sure that we deal with issues that have evolved since the outbreak and the spread of the disease, and has contributed to other parts, other issues in our community. And so they're trying to address some of those more broad, non-COVID specific, but still related. Okay. Health and Human Services, the vaccine confidence programs. Once again, think about in terms of education initiatives, making sure that people in certain communities are involved and vaccinated properly, and that there's a encouragement to do that. Food and Drug Administration, $500 million. Department of Agriculture, $500 million. Various health centers, There's $330 million there. CDC, again, another $500 million for a particular program in analytics and surveillance. And then nursing, medical reserve corps, and behavioral health, some of the big items there. A $9 billion investment in the cybersecurity and information security agency and to improve the technology modernization fund. This is probably the largest single investment in cybersecurity for community needs that I've ever seen. And so there's a lot of cybersecurity projects that'll be on the streets and we're seeing them daily. We have a particular category just for those now. There's a $200 million fund for the information technology oversight. Once again, adding to that concern about cybersecurity related activities and keeping of our information and our data and making sure that that's secure. And then $300 million investment in transformational secure services, some innovative programs there. When those types of innovation programs, when you have ideas, that's the time to bring those forward. You'll use the Small Business Innovation Research Area, or SBIR, and you can Google that and it'll come up to help you explain if you're not familiar with that. So if you are innovative and you got new technology ideas, and you potentially can have funding available for some of that. And then you can see a full text of the bill on this particular blog, and you can link through this from our individual website. And you can see here other types of topics that we've talked about in the past, including a disaster relief contracting. I'm gonna look at the chat box. We'll take a quick sip here. Yes, this section of the site is online, and you can see the same information in our Gov Reporter section. The blog is linked through individual industries as we publish that information. Okay, but you can always just go to govdirections.com/blog and see the last one. But we do link through in the categories to that particular area. And as what I've said earlier, we're traditionally in a $4.5 trillion marketplace just at the federal level, and then some $3 trillion at the local government level, and now we're just just more or less double that marketplace in the past year. So it's an active marketplace. If you are involved in government, it's a good solid business. I was telling somebody just a little while ago, you know, you have in the private sector, you have ups and you have downs. Government's always constant. So having that a part of your business plan is a smart strategy. And just to point out, you know, in the United States, we have a very fragmented government system. And while you may be familiar with, you know, the federal government, don't forget that there are a lot of other organizations that control the expenditure of public funds. These are our cities and towns. There's 35,000 plus cities and towns, 3,000 counties. Counties are subdivisions of states. Oftentimes, that's the way that the money is spread into the local areas through the state appropriation to a county into the businesses in the area. School districts oftentimes receive funding at the federal level, then pass the loan directly to them or through a state agency who are involved in making sure our school systems are available to our kids in a number of areas. And this includes, you know, private sector school systems, charter school systems, we're learning to involving in the way we actually educate our children. So this number here, I've got under 12,800, but there's probably about 17,000 plus school systems that are eligible to receive funding from this latest appropriation. A lot of that's going to go into HVAC work, environmental remediation, in filters, making sure that our school systems are adequately filtering and clean, and making sure they're available for our kids, as there's a concerted effort to make sure all of our schools get reopened in a timely manner. And so watch this. This is the largest single expenditure, I believe, in school related equipment is in our history of the country. So you're seeing a very active marketplace for specifically for HVAC work. 38,000 different special districts. These are hospital systems, airports, parks, recreation districts. And so don't forget about those other agencies that are out, the transit systems, and making sure our transit operations get back up and operating appropriately, that the cleansing is available there, as well as the equipment's necessary to make sure that they stay in a cleansed environment as we move back into a more normal activities. Point out that quickly that sometimes our special districts, the way we organize, they're governed by other governments or even multiple governments, where there's a council of regional governments, for example, or even in our local communities, sometimes we have public-private initiatives or services where they're sort of quasi-public, and they have private sector involvement in those. It could be, for example, our community Main Street programs and others. Each of them all qualify specifically for CDBG funds. That's a community development block grant. And that is one of the ways that they're pushing the funds out into the community. So you'll see some communities will have direct appropriations. It's based on population. Others, the funding will go through the state agency. The state agency then makes the funds available, and then local governments will apply for funds in order to fund to acquire some sort of service or supply or to develop redevelop a product or a building, for example. And so initiatives are often required in order to make that happen. So if you see money that's and you can identify it, sometimes it's helpful to walk in and help that local government understand how to reach that money. And so being ready to go, and that sometimes gives you, it always gives you the leg up in the process. So if you see funds that are available, go into those communities, make them aware of that. These are individuals who live in your community, then they can apply for that. The funds are typically readily available and they can acquire your services to make that happen. In communication activities, in equipment repair activities, a lot of these are below thresholds where there's no competitive bid requirement that is in place or necessary. And so they can go ahead and just acquire services. And so that's important to understand that process. So just to say it's a fragmented system, it's not broken by any means, but fragmented and not likely to change anytime soon. We like to keep that fragmentation in place. It allows us to govern ourselves locally. Is there a way to see what school districts get what? I'm going to show you that as we walk through. Here at the Department of Education, I didn't stage that question, Angela, so thank you for it there. Here's the Department of Education. Here's a press release. And so the initial press release shows the funding for all 50 states. Okay. And so as I click through there, and you can go to the Department of Education, they're, of course, going to every department at this point is going to really promote it. Okay. And once again, I just echo that we're not involved in the actually policy process. So we don't, you know, it's not our intent to highlight any political influence in something like this, but to focus specifically on the procurement item. Okay. So here you'll see, they refer to it as the American Rescue Plan that President Biden is working with. Okay. And I will make, and it's also people are asking me about the links to this. This will be available to everybody who clicked through today. I will send you the slide deck as well as the actual demonstration, okay? And this will have all the links that we have. In addition, at GovDirections, what we do is we break this down to individual items, and they're published in our business intelligence section. And we show you where the funds are at, and we give you a little bit more explanation at GovDirections. But as you walk through here, it would specifically talk about the individual items that they're working with. The first one is improving ventilation. Okay, that is a significant part of the funding mechanism, and also purchasing personal protective equipment for schools. Okay, and then they speak to additional space requirements, so they can ensure social distancing in the areas. So this could be, you know, if you're in the business of providing potentially dividers in the classroom or desk dividers or other types of equipment that can help with social distancing, that's what that refers to. So they can help fund that. Modular buildings to advance the space that they potentially have, outdoor equipment that, you know, to encourage outdoor education or others that can help address the problems with getting folks too close. I know I'm teaching a class at the university now. I have 28 students in the classroom, and whenever I bring them together, we're in a very large classroom now. And so whenever as schools, we start really opening up, that's not going to be as easy to do in order to allow us to bring the kids together. We're going to have to go back into the smaller classroom. So we're going to have smaller classes. And so at that point, what will happen is they'll need more building space, a modular equipment of some sort. And so the government is making these funds available to help them in that process. Okay. So just so you're in that sector, then this is the time to really step forward and offer your services in the community and be rewarded for that. Improving ventilation. If I was a school superintendent now, I would think I would be improving every single HVAC system in my community. I would be applying for it. Okay. I'm going to have already a capital improvement plan in place, most likely. And so you as an individual can go into those individual school systems and look in their budgets and look at their capital improvement plan. And you can see where they had planned on potentially replacing equipment, and they'll probably just move those up first. So you'll know that that's there. But this is the time, though, for them to really step forward and say, give me these funds and I can take my 5-10 year capital improvement. And not only am I going to be able to go ahead and improve the ventilation, but I'm also going to be able to make the school potentially more green and reduce energy requirements and so forth. And so this is the time to help fund some of those projects. And just to say that improving ventilation would be also energy savings. Okay. So if you have, if you're in the business of consulting with energy savings, this is a fund, these are funds available. They're also talking about avoiding layoffs and so forth, but learning loss, providing support to existing staff. So if you're a consultant and you're in education and training issues, coaching, mental health related activities, there's going to be funding available. Okay. Implement set strategies to meet the social, emotional, mental health. Once again, consulting related activities, also evidence-based interventions in the community, helping with training related activities with kids, funding available here. Summer programs, beverages, concessions, food of sorts, moving technology into the home area. These are all projects that we are involved in the private sector. But here's funding for you to move and serve your community at the same time, but offer your services in a contract basis. Hiring additional school personnel, such as nurses, custodial staff, most of that's going to be on a temporary staffing needs, and also augmentation of some sort, not only just in potentially in just these areas, but because it's other additional school personnel, potentially be in IT-related activities, and also education and training-related activities, funding available there for enrichment, especially if you have innovative programs and enrichment activities. Social distancing and safety protocols on buses. So if you're in equipment related with bus production and then making those, this could be inclusive of video production, access to things that divide us and so forth. There, you know your business better than I do, but I've seen a lot of different activities in the area for bus appropriations. And then Wi-Fi hotspots, all of those individuals who are involved in Wi-Fi, there's your money right there. These are this is a very large appropriation that's available. And then they throw in that big old additional uses. So it's a very broad funding measure to help address not only, you know, the quick reopening of our schools, but also getting us ready for the future too. And so don't forget about that part of it. And just to say, this is, I think everybody has made it clear, this is the first step. There's going to be another bill that's already being discussed related to infrastructure in redeveloping our certain areas in our community so that we can deal with these type problems in the future, but also getting our economy back hotter than what it is right now. And so you see here the particular amounts by state, okay? And this is a population-driven demographic formula, typically. And you can, and then it'll be drilled down. But, you know, I was looking at in Georgia, we're at roughly, I think, some $390, maybe even $400 per student, per citizen. So it's about $4.2 billion appropriation going into these type activities just in our state, okay? There will be eventually somebody asking about the individual schools, but as contracts are awarded out and the grants, these will be through grant processes, then that information will be also available and we'll start helping identify those in your individual community. That has not been decided at this point just yet, okay? But they'll be coming forth. Okay? So you can look at the money that's available in your individual community. And I'm going to point out this is just one program that's been announced. And this one here, as I said, it doesn't include the additional $10 billion that's funded in HHS, okay, for screening, testing, and helping making sure everybody's got the vaccine in the education environment. And as also just continue to screen and to contact trace. And they also mentioned the other areas that that are funded in the process. We will continue to monitor the other departments that I mentioned earlier to make sure you're aware of those. Each of the individual acquisitions, FAR is going to be mentioned. This is FAR, and this is the Federal Acquisition Regulation. When you see those acronyms in the announcement of a bid or a request for proposal or a request for information, then you will go to the acquisition.gov, and then it will explain the actual area that you need to excuse me, moving forward too quickly, and be aware of. So total small business is going to be a big part of this. Each acquisition could have a different definition of small business. Traditionally, anything under $250,000 will be available only to small businesses. And then how you qualify is typically self-certifying, but it'll explain to you how to go in there and make sure that you are do qualify. Some of this could potentially, and especially in VA and other agencies, will be driven by other set-asides. It'll always speak to FARM, and then you're able to click on this link at acquisition.gov. Very simple to use. They'll give you a number like 12.5, and on the left-hand side of the page, it'll say area 12. You click on that, and then it'll say area 5, and then it's spelled out in easy-to-understand language. Okay. This also includes disaster relief contracting. If it does speak to disaster relief contracting, it's important to understand that this is all driven by the Thomas T. Stafford Disaster Relief and Emergency Assistance Act, which was signed into law in 88, amended from previous Relief Act of 74, but it requires FEMA to contract with businesses that's typically located in the area when feasible and practical. This is inclusive of, you know, when there's emergency spending, and COVID-related activities could fall under this. So you need to be registered in the appropriate database under SAM to qualify for those funds, even if it's let by the local government oftentimes. So System for Award Management, SAM.gov. And when you search your name on the right-hand side, it'll ask you about emergency spending. This is the website itself. You can just search records. As your name pops up on the right-hand side, it'll show you the actual portal for disaster response registry. And you need to check off that you want to be included in this process, okay? Making sure you're registered appropriately. Links here. When you go online, it's really easy to use. Choose that disaster response registry, okay? And then you'll check that off and walk through that. You don't necessarily need anybody to help you with this. So don't get, a lot of times there'll be what I call being bidwinked. Somebody will call you and say, you need to pay $5.99 to be registered at SAM.gov. It's not required. It's simple to use. You can walk through, get your DUNS number, get your CAGE number. It's a very relatively easy process. You do need help with it, give us a call and we'll walk you through that. And so as I step forward here, I'm getting some questions. I don't quite understand the question, but with this hello. Yeah, sorry about that. We had a power outage. Our bad here. So we're back online now. Just 1 second. I'll go back on. Okay. And we'll continue with that. And I'll make sure this is available to everybody afterwards so we have the full session available. It's an unusual event there. So just 1 second, let me get back to that screen. Okay, so here again, I'll just back up so we'll make sure we have everybody on the same page there. Let me, threw me just a little bit off base there. Okay, so let me get back. Okay, the disaster response registry is at acquisition.gov. And then, of course, when you do click on that, as I mentioned, it takes you to SAM.gov. Easy enough to use. It's not something that you should be overly concerned about registering with. It'll walk you through. I just have that data available when you go in. Okay. And so there, if you do need some help with this, give us a call at 800-492-8523, and we'll walk you through that. I'll give you that number at the end of the presentation. But you do need to be registered there. It's a typical document. This is in FEMA. And it controls that. And that's the document that's available directly there with that link so that you can use that. And then, you know, it's just to point out that FEMA oftentimes funds the actual project through state and local government contracting. So it's important that you're always, you know, I want to encourage people when they talk about registering. Do you register just with one agency, that's SAM.gov, or do you potentially go out and register with all the agencies? Well, you can really waste your time registering all the agencies, okay? Literally, I showed you earlier, there's 100,000 different locations. Even if you just stay within your state, most of us can find at least 4,000 different local, state, and federal agencies within our own state, okay? And so you can go through your entire career just registering. So what I always tell you to do is register with SAM.gov, register with your state office, okay? And you can just type the name of your state, and then Google procurement, and it'll come up. For example, here in Georgia, we have the Georgia Procurement Registry. And then I register either with the largest city or the largest county in my area. And then I stop there, okay? And so at that point, I only register with agencies as I need to go, as I start to do business with them. Because remember, the only thing you're really doing when you're registering with governments is getting ready to be paid by them. So you need to have a contract in place. You have to have it with the state, with the federal government. You have to be registered there because it goes through such an arduous process to get you in that system. So they don't want to award your contract till they know that they can pay you, and they have time deadlines for that. But the state and local governments can move a little quicker, not as much activity. And so, especially the local government level, they really traditionally don't even put you in their accounts payable system until you're awarded a contract. So it's a little opposite. To get notified, a service like GovDirections aggregates. It's a much better way to get the information as opposed to every single individual government reaching out to you. Then oftentimes you're missing opportunities. And then you have third-party systems that are placed out there. These are systems that are used by governments to publish public information. And just to draw attention to that, the fact that all of those are free, the information is freely available. Sometimes it suggests you have to pay them to get access. You don't, just always choose the free option. But you're only really learning about the contracts with the companies, with the governments that they're working with. That's one reason we have always chosen not to work with an individual government. We do allow them to publish our site. And the State Emergency Management Office is always a good place. They traditionally have an RFI, a request for information, published on their website. And you want to make sure you're in their databases just because occasionally they're able to pick up the phone and just call somebody and do business with them. Okay. And so that's important of that process. We get a number of different areas that you can actually click through on the link here to see projects that might be available. And so don't forget about these. When you come to GovDirections, just quickly point out that each of these areas are, we have under categorization at our front page. We actually have particular items that we are linking through. For example, here's PPE related activities. Disaster recovery, and then in each of these, when you pull through them, you will see all the active listings at any given time. You will also find at our site, and I want to talk to you just briefly, as I mentioned to you earlier, about how to work smarter in a system that you can go in and actually do some past performance research, okay? So one of the things we've had our members working with, let me just make sure. Got the right share here. Okay. Here we go. You under the Hughes Winning Stimulus, you will find a report that we do. This is called a past performance report. And what we do is we pull together information related to activities where governments are contracting with you. Okay. That are out there. So right now, one of the areas that we picked up on, and these are all COVID related right now. So you can actually order a past performance report. You have a particular area that you want us to look into, and we can talk to you about that. Just give us a call. But we have research interns who basically go through and pull this data for us so that you can go in, and this one here is particularly for disinfecting wipes. I'm just going to show you how it works. And you can see the original bid that was out there, where it's located at. You can go in our system, and you can drill down into particular areas, see where the activity's at based on the product code. But we also drive you back to the original source of an actual bid. When you're looking at the detail, you can then go in and see, for example, this is the winning company bid this amount, 2.5 cents a product. And you can see what everybody else bid, okay? So enough of these data points, you can actually go in and do some strong analytics, you know exactly where you need to be at in order to win this contract, okay? So for example, if you had bid 60,000 or 12 cent, you just don't have any shot when you're bidding against somebody who's able to bid 2.5 cent. So knowing that going into it, knowing how competitive a project's gonna be is very important. You can do that in a number of different ways. One, you can watch who draws down, they have that information traditionally available for you. As you can see, if there's going to be 20, 30 individuals, don't let that always make you fearful though, because a lot of times individuals will draw down and you can actually look at their names, see what they're doing that for. And they're not actually going to bid on a project. So but this one here, I had a lot of bidders. So this gives me data that I can use to see where I really need to be at. And so if I know that there's not going to be a large number of responses, and I can tell that with a little bit of experience, I might go up and do 20% above the mean a price point on this much of a data scale, because I can afford to walk away from it if I don't get it. If I really need the business, though, I might want to drop down, say, 5 to 10% below that number and bid that number if I can afford it to get the business in order to get additional business from that in the future. And so those are some ways to actually go in and look at the details so that you know where to bid at. HVAC is a big area. For example, we've started collecting data, and you can see that individual types of products over here. So here's, for example, HVAC services that are out there, projects that have recently been awarded. And so as I drill into it, and this is populated daily, and I can see individual projects, okay? So here's HVAC services for the train one in Christiansburg, Virginia. Not only can that, but I also can see ones that are active and when they're gonna be due. Okay, so here's the ones that are coming up, and I can drill that by date. Okay, not only are you able to do that, this is more detailed specific. You can of course do that within the individual RFP categories, where you go in and you do your HVAC area, or you or services, or if you're in a different area of information like PPE, drill into those individual contracts. Only active bids at this point. So I've kind of I wanted to walk through different ways, focusing on the federal government today, different ways to use GovDirections. Apologize for the power outage. These things happen when you're doing live sessions. We want to have this available to you a little bit later today, and it will be sent out a recording to others. I wasn't sure if the GovDirections blog popped up earlier, so I'm going to call attention to that at GovDirections. Promise to do a better job. You get better at this every day. Is it all different kinds of ways to do this? And you just the blog, and then you'll find the individual details that I was trying to point out to you a little earlier. Okay. And have all the individual departments. How about questions? Any questions today? Okay. The number for help, okay, is at 800-492-8523. And just to point out, in your member home account, we have different areas, you know, how to pinpoint. How to learn, how to get advice, okay? Don't have your capability statement, something that you need. Everybody needs one. We oftentimes fail to get that started, right? If you short video on how to do those, call us. We can help you out with that. There's a price point there, but we are offering it as an add-on at no additional charge for all annual subscriptions this month for the entire month of March. If you're not a current member of GovDirections, I would point out their membership rates are available. One of the most affordable services, if not the most affordable, definitely the most comprehensive in the United States. We're all 100% USA based, US onshore. It's $20 per month for access for one state, $40 for a region. If you purchase that annual, this year, it's 200 or 400. And just to point out, even with a 200 annual, we would do the capability statement for you. And that's traditionally a $400 charge. So you save $400. But give us a call. We'll see if we can help you out. Any more final questions? Thank you all for joining in today, and have a great day.